Hi everyone, my name is Lakkaraju. I'm a PhD student at Stanford University. So today I'm here to talk about our recent research on selective labels problem, which is about evaluating algorithmic predictions in the presence of unobservables. So I'll unpack slowly what each of these terms mean. This is joint work with my advisor Yure Leskovich and our collaborators Professor John Kleinberg, Professor Sindhil Mulainathan, and Professor Jens Ludwig. Let me start by discussing some of the decision problems that we see in the real world. For example, in healthcare, one of the main decision problems faced by doctors is what treatments to recommend to patients. In education, an educator or an instructor is trying to understand if a student is at a risk of dropping out. And in criminal justice system, one of the tasks that we have or one of the things that the judge tries to decide on is, will a defendant commit a crime if he or she is released on bail? So humans have traditionally made these kinds of decisions, but today there is a lot of interest in using algorithms for the same. So the goal of this work roughly is to understand how do we compare human and algorithmic decision making, what are the challenges involved, how simple or how hard is it, and you know, what are the approaches that we can use. So before I delve into more details of this problem, so let me start by discussing a couple of things that are different between what humans and what algorithms see in these settings. So the first one is there is an information asymmetry advantage for humans in the sense that human judges can actually observe features that cannot typically be quantified well, such as body language, someone's behavior, and so on. On the other hand, humans are also traditionally known to induce behavioral biases when they make decisions, so that is not exactly considered to be an advantage in decision making. So let me kind of contextualize this task, this talk in the context of something called as bail decision problem. So the rest of the talk and the rest of the things that I explain will heavily rely on this application. So what happens is in the US, police make a lot of arrests every year. And for each of these people, each of these defendants, the judges basically decide whether or not someone should be released on bail. So when the defendants are released on bail, of course, they can be on their best behavior, you know, do well, everything would be fine. But on the other hand, there can be some risky behaviors too, like people, you know, kind of failing to appear for further court dates and committing new crimes when they're released on bail. So essentially, when a judge is making a bail decision, what he or she is trying to do is to predict how risky it is to release a particular defendant on bail. So that is about the human decision making. Now coming to the algorithmic part of it, this seems simple enough. Like at the first look at it, we all would think, why can't we just train a model which takes some of the defendant characteristics like their age and criminal history and socioeconomic background and so on, and we just train an algorithm and we predict if someone will commit a crime in the future, and we can use those to decide who to jail and release. So while at the first look this might look kind of trivial or simple, there are some of challenges that we encounter in these settings which make this much trickier. So the two challenges that we encounter in these settings are problems called selective labels and influence of unobservable variables. So what do these two mean? Let's start with selective labels. So here what we see is a defendant basically appears before the judge, and the judge basically decides if he or she wants to release or jail the defendant. And when released, we can actually observe if the defendant will go out and commit a crime or not, so that can be tracked. But when someone is jailed, when a defendant is jailed, like if the judge refuses the bail, we do not know the actual outcome as to whether the defendant, if released, would have committed a crime or not. So that is where the counterfactual comes into picture, and it makes it harder to have labels for a random sample of the population. So that means we can pretty much rely on training and evaluating on released defendants. That's one way to go. But the point here, or the more bigger point here, is to see that human judges are selectively labeling these data. So in the sense that we do not have labels for all the defendants, instead we have labels only for certain select defendants who have been released by the judges. And that's what we call as the selective labeling problem. So let's see what the prior work has done to address this problem. The first thing is, let's ignore this unlabeled instances, right? So let's try to evaluate, train our models just using the release defendants where we have labels. Now the problem with that is the feature or the conditional output distribution of the jailed and the released defendants often differs, and you know, you will kind of having a lot of, you'll end up having evaluation biases if you completely ignore the unlabeled instances. So there is another approach, which is impute the unlabeled instances, which means for those people which are jailed defendants for whom you do not have labels, essentially find similar people with labels and try to use their labels, you know, to give the labels for these jailed defendants. Now the problem with this is, and this is rather subtle, but it's a very important problem, is this works only when both the human judges and the machine algorithms have access to the same features. So what do I mean by that? Let me give an example. So, and this example also kind of highlights our second problem that we are considering in this work, which is the presence of unobservable variables. So this is basically, again, relating to the information asymmetry problem, where humans and machines don't exactly have same set of features. So let us assume that in the real world, there is a rule that young defendants who are typically polite in court are not risky. They are not likely to go out and, you know, commit new crimes. But on the other hand, young defendants who are rude are risky, right? Algorithms, of course, do not exactly observe this characteristics. It's a very subtle one, hard to quantify. But judges, out of their prior experiences, let us assume they're aware of this, right? So if the judge is aware of this, the judges will typically release young defendants who have polite behavior in court. But what you see in the data is all the young defendants who are released are actually not committing crimes, which is young, releasing a young defendant is good. And if you have an algorithm which tells you to do that, your evaluation will essentially say, well, that's right. I mean, let's just release all the young defendants. So this is the kind of biases that are typically faced by existing solutions which try to address these kinds of problems. So let me just kind of bring all these things back together by iterating what our problem is. We want to evaluate the performance of a given algorithm and benchmark it against human decision making in the presence of selective labels and unobservables. So before we start talking about what exactly is the approach that we are presenting, so I'll just discuss what is it that we are even trying to compare against, right? So let's see this, look at this judge, Jay, who releases 60% of the defendants he sees, right? So the green set comprises of all the defendants released by the judge. The gray set comprises of all the defendants jailed by the judge. And how do we quantify the goodness of the decision-making of this judge? It's by computing the fraction of crimes committed by the defendants who have been released by the judge. So the smaller the crime rate or the smaller this fraction, the better the decision-making of the judge. So that's essentially the, you know, this picture. So given this, our goal is to ask, or rather the question we are trying to ask is, how do we compare the machine or an algorithmic performance with that of this judge Jay's? So for this, we propose an approach called contraction. This approach is actually simple, elegant, but also addresses some of the subtle things or the challenges that I talked about. So what we do here is we look at the most lenient judge, which is the person who releases the highest fraction of the defendants, right? So in that case, just note that we are already trying to kind of push the selective labels problem a bit to the curb, because this person essentially has a data set which is heavily labeled compared to the other people. So that's one point to think about. So now, here again, you know, I've shown both the green and the gray parts. So the green set corresponds to the defendants released by this judge, who is the most lenient one, and the gray corresponds to those jailed. So now let's see, how do we want to compare, you know, human judge and then the algorithm. Remember that we are comparing the performance of the algorithm with that of Judge J. So now we are again taking the set of defendants of Q, who have been jailed and released. Essentially, what we are trying to do is, in order to simulate the algorithm, so the idea here is, let's simulate the algorithm to release 60% of the defendants, and we'll compare the resulting crime rate of the algorithm to that of the human judge J, who releases 60% of the defendants. But in order to do that, because of the selective labels problem, the trick we are employing is let the algorithm jail the same set of people who are being jailed by the defendant, by the most lenient judge Q. And apart from that, in order to jail additional people, what we do is we use the risk scores or the probabilities output by the algorithm to find the most riskiest people and jail them. So in some sense, let's say if the most lenient judge has about, has seen about 100 people and he releases 90 of them, so 10 of them are jailed. So if we want to simulate an algorithm which is competing with a judge who releases 60 people, so we constrain that algorithm to jail the same 10 people as that jailed by the most lenient judge, and the other 30 can actually be jailed from any of the labeled set, but by basically using the algorithm risk scores or the probabilities used by the algorithm or employed by the algorithm. So in this sense, we'll be able to generate a comparable release set corresponding to the algorithm, and we have a similar release set corresponding to the judge J, and we compute crime rates on either of these, and wherever the fraction of the crime is lesser, that is typically touted as the better decision maker. So let me talk a bit in detail about why this works and what are the kind of underlying assumptions. So first of all, we assume that there are multiple judges and there is some heterogeneity in their release rates, right? So there are some variable release rates. It's not like all the judges release the same fraction of people. The second most important assumption is that judges have similar cases. Otherwise, it would not be feasible to compare two sets whose underlying distributions are different. So in some sense, we are assuming that defendants are randomly assigned to judges. The third point, which we have seen happen in the real world, which allows contraction to perform well empirically, is that typically the defendants jailed by the most lenient judges are in fact so risky that most of the algorithmic models that we have trained have actually assigned very high risk scores to them. So that means the agreement rate between who to jail is kind of high typically in real world settings with the defendants who are jailed by the most lenient judge Q. So let me give a brief overview of the worst case error bound. Of course, there is a lot more detail, but just to give you a high level idea of what's going on. So the error in the estimate of the crime rate obtained by the contraction approach that we propose, it typically never exceeds this fraction that you're seeing. Essentially, to break down that particular fraction, so understand that the disagreement or the error stems from those defendants who are jailed by the most lenient judge Q and are recommended for release by the algorithm. So that's where there's a disagreement or error. And just to look at the intuition behind this error rate, so in the best case, let's say if we just release according to the algorithm's wishes, all the people that we are releasing commit no crimes and everything is good. And in the worst case, all the people that we are actually releasing commit crime, and that would be the other side of the error. So this way we can bound the error that we are getting from the contraction technique. So let me start by discussing the experimental evaluation. So we have two sets of experiments, first on the synthetic data and then on the real world. So the synthetic data, we are trying to show a couple of things. So one is how do various techniques evaluate predictive models amidst the selective labels problem. And the second is to understand what is the effect of unobservables on these evaluations. And coming to the real world experiments, we just want to compare human and machine evaluations, which is anyways the goal of this work, and see which one is performing better on what kinds of data sets. So let me start by giving an overview of our synthetic data, the synthetic task. So the setting here is that the human judges see the features which are observed or recorded in the data for the algorithm to see, labeled as X. And they also see some of the unobservable variables labeled as Z, for example, defendants, body language, and so on. And then they make a decision. Now, machine or an algorithm, on the other hand, sees only the features recorded in the data and, of course, does not have access to unobservables. So we set up the synthetic data task in such a way that in this, just for this one task, machine is, we know that the machine is performing worse than the human judges. So that's something we have ensured in the synthetic data generation. So now our goal is evaluating the machine algorithm, which is actually a logistic regression model. So using some of these strategies that I talked about, which is impute, unlabel, and ignored unlabel, which are the prior approaches to addressing the selective labels problem, and of course, our approach contraction. So let me show you on the synthetic data what's going on with the true performance of the machine and the humans, right? So there are these red and green curves, and on the x-axis, we plot the release rate, which is the fraction of the people that are being released by either the machine, or which means the algorithm, or the human judge. And the y-axis is the crime rate, which means what fraction of these people that either the algorithm or judge are releasing are actually committing crimes. So the green is the machine performance in this case, in the synthetic data case, and the red is the human performance, and these are both true. So because we see everything in the synthetic data, otherwise we would never be able to plot the green curve. So what we see is, of course, as I said, machine is performing worse than the human judges in this case, right? Because you see that the crime rates are higher, and higher crime rates are bad. So that's the ground truth we have, which is human judges have lower crime rates and are performing better than machines or algorithms. Now let's see what some of the baselines that we are using to kind of estimate these curves are telling us. So if you see ignore unlabeled, which is magenta, and impute unlabeled using propensity score matching algorithm, which is the brown curve, they are both kind of showing that the human judges are in fact performing worse than the machine that we have trained, which is actually not true, right? So we just saw that the true performance is in fact worse in the case of the machines. So that is one thing which is they are kind of underestimating how bad the machines are doing or the algorithms are doing. So now let's see what our approach is doing, which is the blue curve contraction. And here you can see that the curve is pretty close to the true performance, the true machine performance. And at the same time, it's also telling the thing that is actually true with the data, which is the human judges are performing better than the machine or the algorithm in this case. So, and it's reflecting that insight very accurately. So coming to the next set of results, which is effect of unobservables, on the x-axis I'm plotting the influence of the unobservables, which is basically a parameter in our synthetic data generation, which allows us to control what is the effect of the unobservables relative to that of the observed features in the data in influencing the outcomes. And on the y-axis, we have mean absolute error with respect to the true performance of the machine. So what you can see is on the top at higher crime rates are a bunch of baselines that we have talked about, which is ignore unlabeled, impute unlabeled using various strategies like gradient boosting, nearest neighbor, propensity score, doubly robust estimation, and logistic regression. So as you can see, so these error estimates are kind of higher than that of the contraction curve, which is at the bottom. At the same time, they're also kind of increasing swiftly with the as we increase the effect of the unobservables or the influence of the unobservables. Whereas the bottommost curve is not only producing reliable estimates, but is also kind of the error rate is not increasing very drastically as compared to the other baselines. So let me now start discussing about the real-world data sets that we experimented with. So we had three different real-world data sets. So one is based on the bail decisions. The other is based on, or rather comprising of insurance decisions, where the decision is whether someone should apply an insurance policy, approve an insurance policy or deny it. So it's the decision made by insurance managers for clients. And the last one is about healthcare, where the doctors are trying to decide if some patient should be given quick relief drugs versus long-term controller drugs. So for the purpose of this talk, I'll focus exclusively on the bail decisions dataset. So essentially, we have about 18 judges with 9K subjects and various attributes about the defendants, such as the demographics, previous criminal history, are recorded, and of course, the judges' decisions of whether someone has been released or jailed are recorded, along with the outcomes which indicate whether someone has committed a crime or not. So this plot again shows three curves. So one baseline, one human performance or what human judges are doing, and the other is our approach. The topmost one, which is the red curve, shows that human judges are, you know, kind of performing probably worse than the machines. In this case, that is, algorithms are being more effective. So the second curve that you see is that of contraction, which is the blue curve. So why do I know that this particular curve is actually correct? It's because thanks to our worst case error bound, we in fact found that the worst case error bound shows that this curve is like pretty close to, you know, kind of the curve that we have plotted. So the bound is in fact like quite tight. So last we see is the curve which is in black, which is the ignore unlabeled, where we only use the instances which have been labeled in the data and we just ignore those which don't have labels. As you can see, since we know that contraction is doing the right thing based on the worst case error bounds, so this one we can then say that this is basically underestimating again, you know, the crime rates of the machines. That means it's over optimistic in terms of how well the machines or algorithms are doing. So again, as I said, so it's like machine has lower crime rate compared to the human judge. That's one insight. And of course, the baseline, which is ignore unlabeled, is underestimating the machine crime rate. So coming to the summary of this talk, so in this talk, we address the problem of comparing human and algorithmic decision making in the presence of two problems, selective labels and influence of unobservables on outcomes. So not just the applications that I talked about today, in fact, there are many other applications like credit scoring, recommender systems, etc., which are prone to both of these problems. And our contraction technique, as we showed both empirically and with some of the worst case error bounds, can accurately estimate machine performance in such settings. So with this, I would like to conclude my talk. Thank you so much.
Any questions?